I'm here at the EBA Day 2015, the European Bank Day, where all the existing banks, the powerhouses of Europe, are together to discuss the technology trends and the banking trends of tomorrow. And I'm going to interview a guy who knows them all, who's been in this world forever. David Bannister, you're the editor-in-chief of Banking Technology. We're here together at 2015. We had 6 years of crisis. The banks are totally lost confidence, totally lost funding. What are the hot topics now in 2015? I see everybody very relaxed here.
Everybody seems very relaxed, but I think it's the old swans pedaling very madly underneath. This is an interesting conference, and particularly this year, as you say, 6 years of crisis. The banks have been kind of battered and a bit, it sounds a bit weird, but sort of ashamed almost in the last few years, and perhaps they should be as well. A lot of people would agree with that.
They actually feel ashamed, because we, from the outside world, we always think that they think they deserve all these bonuses and all those things by God given and by country.
Well, to be fair to the people at this particular conference, this isn't the guys that are getting all the big bonuses. These are the plumbers.
They're the technical guys.
Yeah, and they're not exactly shabbily paid, but what they're really trying to grapple with is all these changes in technologies you're seeing coming through from the consumer world, where you're going to put this on YouTube in about 15 seconds. That kind of real-time environment.
In the batch-oriented world of the 50-year-old back office of the banks.
There is one bank here whose CIO, a Nordic bank, told me that they have Soviet-era mainframes running their systems. And it's just probably true. And why not? They just add and subtract numbers. There's no big reason. But the batch thing is a big problem. And so how do you get rid of that billions of euro investment and take that forward and deal with the kind of issues that you see now, where everybody is transacting 24/7 globally?
Which actually isn't very controversial. This is just plumbing. It works. It's maybe a little bit expensive, but it works. And it needs to be work reliable. So if you look at, do these people feel threatened by the Googles or by all these, by the Ubers of the banking world?
Yeah, they do, because they don't know what's coming, and they know something's happening. And one of the speakers earlier on said, you know, we're in a big, you know, on the cusp of a big, big change here. And lots of people here actually will welcome that, and they're looking forward to it. But it's the day job is actually keeping the systems working and making that transition to the new world at the same time. So you can look at all these things and say, well, you know, blockchain is a fantastic, good idea, but it's kind of not ready for prime time at the moment. But it will be maybe 5 years' time. So there's,
if you talk about Bitcoin and if you talk about blockchain, do they see that as a foundation for the next level, the next technology?
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting. Well, Bitcoin less so. Bitcoin is seen as, well, a bit of a sideshow. But the blockchain technology that underlies it, everybody's very excited about that and the potential for using it. And in a way, it's just another evolution. I mean, when Swift, for instance, set up its network, it was to replace a fax. And then they replaced that. That was on the old IBM X25 networks. Then they moved to TCP/IP networks. It's not much of a step change to move to a Ripple type network. But that does also change the intermediary side of banks, because you've got a point-to-point connection with Ripple. It's global. It's a decentralized ledger. It's, you know, kind of safer, and it sounds very good. But it changes the correspondent banking relationships as you move around the world.
So blockchain is something which can basically innovate the existing old one central point system to a decentralized blockchain kind of system. But what about all these things, like we have standards coming up, you know, to open up the information? You just had a session about the standard. What's it called?
The API, the application programming interface. Well, that's
no, the standard that they have to open up their account information, PDF2.
PSD2, the payments. It's not a standard. It's a directive from the Euro, and it's the second version of an existing one. And what it does is it says a couple of things. One, they have to have this access to accounts. So the new kind of payment processors, which are the telco companies and the utility companies, who will, you know, currently you have some sort of charging mechanism for your electricity bill or whatever, they can become payment processors in their own right, PSPs, payment service providers, and they'll be able to interact with your bank in a much more sort of intimate way almost. But the way of doing it,
I can basically ignore my own bank. I can have a nice user interface for all my different banks and have one way to work with it and then one way to present it and one way to report it. So at last the bank will not be in front of me, but it will be somewhere on the back.
Yeah, that's the opportunity. Some banks see that as a great opportunity. They can take control. They can offer consumers a wider range of services that currently they offer to the rich, you know, the uber wealthy and the high net worth individuals who get the kind of concierge services you see with credit cards. They'll be able to do that in a much more fluid way, in the way that the apps on your phone are all integrated, because you know you're videoing there. You're going to put that. There's an API in your phone that puts it on YouTube or whatever, or SoundCloud or whatever app you're using. That model already exists, and moving data from one place to another in the consumer world of iPhones and social media is already there.
Hooray! So for 50% of the banks was afraid to lose customers, which meant in a review in a survey, 50% wasn't afraid to lose customers because of this technology.
Well, I think
directive.
Yeah, well, people looked at the directive and thought, oh my God, here's another. You know, there's been a huge amount of regulation in the last 7 years since the crisis, and again, quite rightly too. But it's cost a lot of money. So as well as trying to run these old batch systems, they're also putting in compliance systems. So the budgets they have for renewing IT or doing anything in any way innovative is being taken up with reporting systems for the, you know, so that they can report to the local regulators. And that's kind of coming to an end. So you know, the innovation money is starting to get freed up.
But okay. But this PSD2, okay. That's actually a positive thing. That is not an bother, don't bother us. This is something which new people can use to get into this industry and make a much better user interface and a much better experience.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think people are starting to realize that. Another session we've just done was about the opportunities. And if we'd had that session a year ago, people would have been talking about the threat of PSD2. The whole mindset is changing. Now, 50-50, I think it's probably a bit unkind in some of that survey. I think most people in most banks know the change is happening, will welcome it, do worry about their day job.
You know. Okay, so the words are openness, competition from outside, blockchain, API, app stores.
And a whole range of potential new services where you're much more integrated into your personal finance. So a consumer will be able to, you know, look after their pensions, do their investments, all pretty much from their mobile device. You know, tablet banking is really on the way.
Can't wait. But David, you've been around forever, okay? You've been through every computer industry, a revolution from the PC, etc. Now, how fast will this industry change? It was the slowest possible industry ever. And people changed partners much faster then they change banks. You know, it's really unbelievable how slow people change banks. Will this now really start to change?
Yeah, I mean, we're already seeing that in the UK where they brought in legislation you can have a 7-day switching service. And that's gradually improving. The numbers aren't great. I mean, I think we worked out once that it will take 17 years for everybody to leave HSBC or Barclays at the current rates. But it is moving. We are seeing that kind of flexibility.
Will it accelerate or will it be the same slow speed we've been seeing the last 10 years?
I mean, it's accelerating now. You can almost feel it. What's the so-called challenger banks that are coming in? The newer...
The fintechs, are they really challengers?
Well, fintech is, I'm slightly cynical about the phrase fintech because it's been, banking technology has been going 30 years. You know, banks have always embraced new technologies. They were first people to go into personal computers. That's how I ended up writing about this whole world. They were the people that spent more money on large IBM mainframes than the military did. You know, so they've always embraced technology. It's just got a bit harder to do it quickly. And well, 10 years ago, people would have told me at conferences there are too many banks in the world. There's 8,000 in Germany or something. Now they're telling me there's not enough competition. And you know, so the competition
in Holland, that is totally true. ING, ABN, we don't have competition.
Yeah, but so it's a concentration really. The newer people that are coming along are tending to offer single services, like the old ING Direct, for instance. That's a savings account that piggy banked on other things, and it was good and it was successful in various territories. You'll now be able to take one of those type services from one organization and mix it through in the APIs into some sort of aggregated service that you create yourself. You probably be able to, my daughter will probably be writing the programs to do that. She's
David Bannister, thank you very much. This was the first interview from the European Banking Day, and we're going to do a lot more, but it's going to be interesting. The speed is accelerating.